Hi, DJ Spiess here at DJU.com. If you're writing a JEE application in Java, you're going to need a data source. There aren't too many applications I can think of without a database of some type. Configuring a data source in Wildfly is pretty easy. In fact, there's several ways to do it. Each have their pros and cons, and that's what I'm going to show you in this video. Three ways to add a data source to Wildfly coming up next. So in this lesson, the goal is to go from a fresh install with a user created to a configured data source in Wildfly. We'll look at adding it in the management console first. Then we'll add a data source to Wildfly by modifying the Standalone.xml file. We'll do the same thing again, but we'll add it from the command line interface. And when we're done, we'll look at the benefits of each method. If you don't have Wildfly installed on your machine, you might want to look at four steps to get you started with Wildfly lesson first. In this video, I'm using Wildfly 9.0.1 final. Start up Wildfly if you haven't already. For this video, we're going to use Postgres, but the steps work for any database. I'm also assuming your database is installed, up and running, and has a database created in it. I called mine Demo 1. In all three methods, you're really doing the same two steps. The first step is to load the JDBC driver into Wildfly. The second step is to configure your data source. Usually, if you Google the name of your database and add the words JDBC driver, that'll take you to the download page. You'll also need the JDBC connection string for your database server. That looks like something like this. Okay, let's dive in. First, let's do this from the UI. The first thing you need to do is open up the console apt in your browser. Here's the address if you forgot how to get there. If you're connecting to a server that isn't local, you'll need to change the URI to match your server. You'll come to a page that looks like this. Click on Create a Deployment. To the left, you'll have all the current deployments. We're starting from a clean Wildfly installation here, so mine's empty. Click Add. This brings the wizard up to walkthrough. Select Upload a New Deployment, and then Next. Click Choose File and navigate to the location on your computer where you stored your JDBC driver. Once you've selected your JDBC driver, click Next. On the final page, you can update the name if you like. I usually change it to be the database name and version. In this case, PostgreSQL. I'll leave the runtime name as it is. Basically, the name is how the deployment is known to your users. It's got to be unique. The runtime name is how it's known to the server. This way you can have multiple names, but they can point to the same runtime name. Or not. Depends on how you want your environment set up. Make sure you check Enable and then press Finish. Your JDBC driver is now available. Click back on Home. The next task is to create the data source, so click on Data Sources. This will bring up another wizard. Select the data source type. In this case, I'm selecting PostgreSQL data source. Click Next. On the Data Source Attributes page, give the data source a name and a JINDI name. This is how your application is going to see your data source, so the name and the JINDI name must be unique. Make sure you keep the Java colon part in your JINDI name. Click Next. When it asks you to select a driver, click Detected Driver tab. That will give you a list of JDBC drivers installed in Wildfly. You should see the driver you just installed. Click that one, then click Next. Update the connection URI to match your server. You'll also want to update the username and password to match your credentials. Then click Test Connection. If it fails, the error will have the Details button to tell you why it failed. Otherwise, it'll say success, and you have added a data source to Wildfly. Behind the scenes, the management console is updating the standalone.xml file. If you're not familiar with Wildfly, the standalone.xml file is a configuration script for your server. It contains configuration for everything you want to run in your server. Let's do everything we did in the first segment of this video, but let's do it manually. So we need to add the JDBC driver first. Navigate to the module systems layers base directory in your Wildfly directory. Create the subfolders org, PostgreSQL, main. The subfolders need to match the package structure of your JDBC driver. So if you're using an Oracle database, you'll want to create like com Oracle main. Copy your JDBC driver into the directory you created. Next, you need to create an XML file in the directory called module.xml. The XML file looks like this. make sure the resource root element path matches the exact name of your JDBC driver. Next, we need to edit the standalone XML file in the Wildfly standalone directory. Look for the drivers element. It should be in the data sources element. We need to add the driver here with the following XML snippet. This adds the driver to Wildfly. Now we need to configure the data source. Just above in the data sources element, add this XML snippet. Restart Wildfly and you should be good to go. You can verify your connections in the management console. The final way to show you is to add your data source via the command line interface. It's often abbreviated as the CLI. The CLI can be a whole series of videos on its own, but basically the CLI is a special command line interface to communicate with the Wildfly application server. It has two advantages. You can automate your interaction with the Wildfly server through a script, and you can run this on a running Wildfly server. Again, the process is broken into two steps. We'll first start the command line interface with the following command. Then we'll install the JDBC jar. We do this by loading the jar by adding a module. This is the command to do that. Then we add the driver to the data sources subsystem. We do that with this command. Finally, we create the data source that uses the JDBC driver we just installed. And that should be it. Again, we can test it by going into the management console for Wildfly. So, how do these three methods compare? Well, the first method is the easiest. There's no coding and it requires just a few clicks. The downside is you need to access to the management console. Depending on how your DevOps operates at your company, this might be a non-starter. You don't really want people logging into your system to make changes. It's a security issue. The second method is good because you can provide the XML as part of your deployment. If you have other multiple applications running on the server, that might not be the best idea. Different groups might write over each other's changes in the standalone.xml. So it creates a versioning issue for the operations team. The other problem is you got to reboot the server to add the data source. The third option is really the best from a DevOps perspective. You can provide a script that is run when you install your application. This script can be part of your standard deployment, and you can create a script that starts with a fresh installation. That plays well with technologies like Docker. That's the three ways you can install a data source in Wildfly. You can add it through the Wildfly management console, you can add it through the standalone.xml file, or you can add it through the CLI. You should now have a data source you can use for your JE applications. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments below, and I'll see you in the next video. Hey, thanks for watching the video. There's a quick quiz for this on dgu.com if you'd like to gauge how much you learned. If you like the videos you're seeing, please let me know by liking the video and hitting the subscribe button for the DGU channel on YouTube. I'd really appreciate that. If you have concerns or questions, please leave them in the comments below or on dgu.com. There's a poll on the front page of dgu.com, so you can also let me know what topic gets covered next. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.